Welcome to Freedom. It is so good to have you joining us. Maybe you're joining us online, perhaps in one of our home churches, or you're maybe in one of our venues where we're able to gather again. It's awesome to have you here. Wherever you are, do you want to make some noise? Get excited with the people around you, because it's great to be gathering together and see what God is going to do amongst us and in us today. And it's especially great to have you here if you're here for the first time.
If you are here for the first time, we want to get to know you a little bit more. So if you're online, you can check us out on social media. Mm-hmm. If you're watching on Facebook, you can join the chat with the rest of the location. Or if you're actually in one of our buildings, we want to spend some time with you. So stick around after, chat to some people, or see what you can do to get more involved in the week.
Absolutely. If you're here for the first time, Freedom Church is a global movement of churches all around the world. And, you know, one of the things that's been such a privilege, even in this challenging season, is being able to go through it together. We've been in this together. And we had the exciting news last week. Then on October 3rd of this year, 2020, we're going to be doing The Cave together, streamed all around the world, and it's going to be absolutely incredible. If you don't know what The Cave is, it's our annual event, our annual gathering, where we hear what God is unleashing and unlocking in vision for the season to come. It's pretty wild. And there was an unbelievable response last week when people heard we're going to do The Cave, wasn't there?
There were some amazing responses, and we were in the Hereford location, but we also put some secret cameras in some of your homes.
Your homes?
Because we wanted to catch what you thought about The Cave on the 3rd.
Come on. This is the Wilson family in Australia. They've been so excited watching church online. And when they heard the news of The Cave, this was their reaction. High five, guys. High five. We've had a group of friends connecting in from Brazil. They were just so desperate to hear the news. And when it came through, that's right, everybody, confetti cannons. You can expect some of these at The Cave. This is Nick from somewhere near the North Pole. He's been connecting in every week. Oh, look at the relief. What a gift. Just like Christmas. I can't believe that Father Christmas is going to be coming to The Cave.
I can't wait to meet him.
I know. But seriously, it was great to see everybody getting so pumped about The Cave this year.
Now, I want to know what your favorite cave moments are. And
come
so
on.
If you've been to The Cave before, maybe you've got a photo, a video, a memory on your Instagram. We would love you to at mention Freedom Church, and let's get some anticipation and excitement for how The Cave's going to be.
Absolutely. Now, The Cave's incredible because God moves, doesn't he?
He does.
Speaks powerfully.
Yeah. I think one of my favorite moments has got to be the Driven by Eternity Cave, or it was called Eternity, where Charlotte Snozer was performing at
so
the end.
Powerful.
And the actors just brought such life to God's word. It was so beautiful. You can check out a film that we made called Stronger that we produced a few years ago for one of our caves. And here's a little taster for you.
Man, it's so good, isn't it?
It's brilliant.
Love the creativity in our church. And if you want to watch the rest of that film, you can watch it at this link where you'll find that and some of the other creative things that we've done over the years.
We're going to take some time together now, wherever you are around the world, in your homes or in our venues, to do communion together.
Yeah, it's going to be so powerful. So maybe you came ready, perhaps you didn't know it was on, but we've got teams that are ready to help you out and serve you in that way. But before we take communion together, we're going to worship God. So get ready, give it your all. This is going to be a powerful time together as we get ready to hear what God is going to say to us today.
Buried everything. as I rise with you. And I'm gonna
Hey Freedom Church, we are so delighted to have you with us to share communion together. One of the things about communion is that it was designed to be shared in homes, with community, with friends, with church family. And there's something amazing about, as we watch this together now, we're going to have communion together. So I encourage you to get your bread, get your wine, get your grape juice, whatever that looks like for you, where you are. Maybe it's a cracker, maybe that's all you can find. But you know what? Jesus doesn't mind, because we're going to celebrate and be thankful for his life right now. I'm just going to share these verses from Matthew 26, where we can really remember what communion is all about. It says in verse 26, while they were eating, Jesus took the bread, and when he'd given thanks, he broke it, and he gave it to his disciples, saying, take and eat, this is my body. Then he took a cup, and when he'd given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins. So, guys, as we take the bread and the wine today, we're going to remember Jesus and what he did for us, the sacrifice that he made for us on the cross, the victory that we have in the resurrection. And we're going to share this special moment together. Lord, I want to thank you for this bread. I want to thank you, Lord, for your body that was broken for us. And Lord, we thank you for your blood that was shed for us, that gives us the forgiveness of sins, that gives us new life. So guys, it's so important that we get to celebrate communion together, to be able to do it with friends, family, church, community, and honor and remember the life of Jesus and what he's done for us. So we're now going to have a time of worship and go into this song. So let's sing together.
Amen. Father. Just to
Are you ready to listen?
Now, just forget the term Christian.
For this is the root of all human truth.
The moral alignment for the old.
And the youth.
It's a lamp to our feet.
It helps make us complete.
From the origin and source.
A love-fueled force.
The mind of the maker.
No ideas are greater.
You can ignore it.
Or explore it.
You can choose to forget it.
But it will transform your life.
If you let it.
This is The Word.
I want to talk to you today about going around in circles. I have a 2-year-old daughter who absolutely loves to run round and round in circles. It's something she spends a few minutes of each day doing. She gets so much joy and pleasure from the simple act of running round and round in circles that one day my wife and I were watching and we said, we should give this a try. So we actually have taken to joining in with her. And I can guarantee you that it's actually a really enjoyable thing to do, running around in circles. If you've got nowhere else you want to go, nothing else that you're looking to do and nothing you're looking to achieve, then going around in circles is actually a very fun and pleasurable way, a liberating way perhaps, to spend a few minutes of your day. Now, I don't want to talk to you about literally going around in circles, although I would suggest you give it a try after the message. I'm talking about going around in circles in the metaphoric sense or in the figurative sense, the idea that in our lives we can find ourselves revisiting the same issues over and over again, whether we're talking about daily or sort of weekly responses or thought patterns, or whether we're looking back through the seasons of our life and we can identify that whilst the faces and the places change, the circumstances seem somehow to be on repeat. I want to talk to you about going around in those kind of circles and the idea that as people we can find ourselves revisiting the same issues, the same circumstances, the same behavioral responses or emotional responses or mental processes over and over again, that we can repeat the way that we respond or act, and in so doing, we find ourselves just literally going round in circles. I think most of us, if we were honest, would say we like the idea of life that is progressive, where we work through things and move beyond things. Now, it's certainly true in my life that I can identify quite a number of times when I've gone round in circles. And I want to talk today about that. And I want to talk about how we break cycles in our lives that are getting in the way, perhaps even holding us back from stepping into more of what God has got for us. Now, before I jump into the deep end, I just want to say this. It's true that there are moments where going around in circles is necessary or inevitable in our life. If you're anything like me, I don't typically tend to learn everything the first time round. Sometimes I have to do things twice or three times. It's what I call kind of the arcade game kind of logic. This idea that if you, I don't know if you've ever played a game on an Xbox or a PlayStation or even on your smartphone, you can be playing a certain level in that game and you keep getting knocked out at the same point. The same thing seems to happen over and over, and you have to do it two or three times to get past that point in the game, to be able to continue in the game. Our lives are a little bit like this. Now, God uses these moments powerfully, and there's a story in the Bible, the story of Jericho. We actually spoke about it last week as well in Freedom Church, where God's battle plan or instruction to Joshua and through Joshua to his people was to go round in circles. In the story of Jericho, God instructs his people to circle Jericho, what totals at 13 times, going round and round in circles in order to see the walls come tumbling down. I think there's a song in that somewhere. But the point is this, there is something about circling through persistence, circling through prayer as a strategy. But it's also true that God's people didn't just then carry on going round in circles, having overcome, having conquered that obstacle, having achieved what God had for them to achieve through their perseverance, they went on to move forward and take possession of the promised land. And it's like a picture of how in our lives, sometimes we'll have to circle, and God can use that powerfully. But actually, once having circled things a few times, we want to move forward. And ideally, if we can avoid circling at all, then, you know, that's almost the more favorable approach, a more favorable battle plan. There are stories in the Bible that kind of present that present circular patterns or going around in circles, not as a positive thing, not as God's best, but actually as a consequence of human nature and as an inevitable outcome when people make the same decisions over and over again. And actually, this is something of a theme. If you fast forward from Joshua leading the people into the promised land, where they settle into the promised land, and as they move forward, there's this pattern that starts to emerge. But, you know, in the book of Judges, you can read about this between Judges 3 and Judges 16, you can read about a pattern that happens a total of 12 times. And it's the pattern of going round in circles because the people compromise on God's best. They respond or they react to circumstance in a way that causes consequence for them. And it's basically a very simple pattern that repeats itself over and over. The people forget God and they forget his ways. And so they compromise in a way that's sinful, and they end up having to pay the consequence or the price of that mistake. It's usually in the form of an invasion. God then will raise somebody up to help liberate them, which usually sounds like them crying out to God and saying, God, we're sorry, would you rescue us? And God rescues them, only to find out a little time later that they forget God, and the circular pattern, the going round in circles, begins, and it repeats over and over and over again. And with it comes great consequence. We don't want to live lives like that. But I think we can all relate to this idea that actually we've heard ourselves say, or we've said to one another if we're married or within friendship groups, why is this happening to me again? There's something familiar about this. I want to use a personal example just to kind of bring this alive. And I can think of lots of examples in my life where I've found myself saying those words, why is this happening again? But one of the examples I want to share with you is a very practical one, and it's about the use of debt in my adult life. There have been a number of moments in my adult life where I found myself making the same decision. I've wanted or I've needed something, and I found myself saying, I've got this need, God, would you help me meet this need? And very quickly, what I found myself doing is reaching out for a credit card or perhaps taking on board a personal loan or a hire purchase to solve what I perceive as my need, only to have to then take a lot of time to pay off that debt. And you reach the final payment and it's like relief, the debt's been repaid, I'm free again, only to find yourself, or only for me to find myself, facing another need. And what do? I pray and say, God, would you help me? And then I reach my credit card or I borrow in order to meet that need. And it's like a cycle that repeats itself over and over. The reason I'm sharing this is a number of years ago, God really challenged me on this. And he challenged me really in two ways. He challenged me and said to me, you know, what you perceive as a need isn't always a need, it's more of a desire. And if you stuck to the things that you really needed, that I provided for, you wouldn't find yourself getting into debt. The second thing that he challenged me on is he said, and by the way, sometimes you'll cry out to me and say, will you help me with this, God? And before I have the time to deliver the provision into your situation, you fix the problem yourself. And in so doing, you've indebted yourself. And, you know, I can recognize this cycle having repeated itself a number of times. And when God challenged me on it, you know, I cried out to God. I said, God, I'm sorry that I've been doing this. The challenge that he brought to my life, I had to do this thing that's a bit, you know, it's an unusual word in today's society, but I had to repent. I had to say to him, God, this isn't your best, and this is evidently not what you want for me, so I'm sorry for that. And repentance also, you know, necessarily involves us doing something different, turning and moving in the opposite direction. And so we had to pay off our debt, and we had to stop seeing debt as an option for solving our needs or our perceived problems. And instead, we had to start saying, God, would you provide what we need? And the amazing thing about this is we were liberated from the weight of these repayments. Our budget improved, and we've seen God honor that determination, that discipline. There was a cycle in our lives. It was fueled by certain patterns in our decision-making and in our behavior, but we were able to break free. The key for us of breaking out of the cycle was the key of discipline. It was the key of trusting God. And it's just an example for me of how we can find ourselves caught up in these cycles. You know, going around in circles for me has been driven by my same choices on repeat. And when we choose to respond over and over in the same way, we'll just find ourselves going round in circles. We have to make a different choice to break out of the cycle, because we have to recognize that our choices, they have the power to make or to break our lives. We have this incredible gift called choice, the power to decide, the power to choose. And as we exercise that with wisdom, we see ourselves break out of cycles, or we see ourselves avoiding cycles in the first place. But when we make the same choices, or certainly this is what I found when I made the same poor or questionable choices over and over again, whether it's about my money or the way I respond to conflict or other things, it can cause me to get stuck in the cycle. God wants us to break out of these cycles and to break into more of what he has for us. Now, I just want to make sure that there's a bit of balance in this. I want you to hear me. Not everything that happens to us in life is a consequence of our choices or is our fault. Things happen to us. You know, one of the great philosophical questions that humanity has been grappling with through the generations is, why do bad things happen to good people? And you may be listening to this, finding yourself in very difficult circumstances right now. I'm not saying that your difficult circumstances are somehow necessarily your fault. What I want to speak to today are those patterns, those cycles that happen 2, 3, 4, 5 times. If 4 or 5 times you found yourself in exactly the same set of circumstances, again, perhaps the season, the time frame is different, the name or the place is different, but the underlying reaction inside of us or the behavior that we're demonstrating is the same. We've got to look at this and say, this seems to be a cycle that is on repeat in our lives. I also just want to say this, that not all of us have the same, you know, range of choices available to us. Sometimes we can actually find ourselves with a very limited number of choices in life. But I really believe that God has given us all the power to choose. You know, Joshua, I mentioned about Joshua and leading the people in taking Jericho. Joshua, at the end of his life, repeated something very similar to what Moses, at the end of his life, said to the people. You know, recognizing that his leadership was heading to an end and recognizing that he was having to pass on the baton to the next generation, Joshua basically said this. He said, you need to choose who you're going to follow in your life. You have the capacity to choose. Choose for yourselves. He actually said, you know, if it doesn't please you to follow God, then you need to choose which God you will follow. But as for me and my house, we will follow, we will serve the Lord. We're going to choose that way. I think we do have the capacity to choose. And sometimes it can be tempting to almost let go of our ability to choose by saying we don't have choice. We're almost victims of circumstance. And again, you know, things can happen to us that are beyond our capacity to influence. But how we respond to those things, I think we do have the power to choose, the power to shape our responses for either better or for worse. Cycles are driven by how we think, how we feel, and what we choose, and our choices have, I believe, the power to make or to break our lives. So I just want to share with you 3, 4 other examples of cycles that I think we can find ourselves caught up in. I'm just going to be honest with you. I'm not determined this list from looking at other people's lives. I've determined this list from looking at the cycles that I've got caught up in my life. This isn't an exhaustive list, but I do hope that it will help you know, help you sort of provoke some thinking within you about potential cycles that you find yourself in. I've already talked about the debt cycle. I want to talk about the cycle of sin. The cycle of sin. The Bible talks about all kinds of forms of sin. Sin is something that God doesn't want for our lives. We have this incredible gift of God's grace and forgiveness that has dealt a blow to the power of sin, overcome the power of sin in our lives when we follow Jesus. But that doesn't mean that we therefore always act perfectly. We can still make mistakes. We can still stumble. And sometimes that sinful practice or that sinful behavior can be a recurring pattern in our lives. Maybe there are one, two, three sort of areas of vulnerability that we can find ourselves drawn to stumble in, whether it's something like criticism or gossip, these things are sinful, or whether it's something like, you know, physical sin or lust. They're all different types of sin. And we can find ourselves repeating or revisiting that sin, that area of compromise over and over again, driven by the sense that we don't have the power, the strength to persevere or overcome the sin, but instead we compromise, we give in to the temptation. I think the key to breaking the cycle of sin, one of the keys to breaking the cycle of sin, is the key of accountability. You know, sin often really kind of grows or perpetuates in the shadows of our lives. When we let the light in, when we go to somebody who is trustworthy, a leader or somebody else that we know that we can count on, and say to them, look, I'm struggling in this area, when we confess our sins, it can bring help to bring breakthrough in our lives. The Bible says if you confess your sins to each other, you'll be healed. This, you know, accountability is us saying to somebody else, hey, I'm struggling in this area and I'm going to keep you posted on how I'm doing. And if I don't from time to time, would you ask me what's going on in this area? There are different forms of accountability, but accountability is a key to break the cycle of sin. I think another cycle that we can have in our lives is the cycle of conflict. Now, you know, I think it's possible, there was certainly a season in my life where I seemed to find myself caught up in conflict over and over again. It's like every relationship, whether it was a work relationship, whether it was a personal church relationship, whether it was even just like when I went out shopping and bought things, I always seemed to be getting into conflict with people. It was like I was always sort of feeling that people had let me down, that they hadn't lived up, that what they were doing was offensive. And I, you know, I was always seemed to be writing a letter of complaint to somebody. That conflict became a recurring pattern. Do you know what it was actually fueled by? It wasn't fueled by everybody else. What were they doing? It was actually fueled by my tendency to pick up offense. And then an unwillingness on my part to forgive. I got caught up in this thing, unforgiveness, where we hold on to offense and we don't let people go. That was what was fueling the cycle of conflict for me. And maybe you can relate to this. If you think carefully about patterns in your life, have there been 3, 4, 5, 6 times? Is it kind of a default for you that relationships end up in conflict? You always find yourself having the same frustrations with the people around you, especially people that God places in your life to bring perhaps some leadership. I think one of the keys to break the cycle of conflict is the key of forgiveness, where we say, actually, I'm going to forgive where I perceive myself to have been wronged, and I'm going to invest myself in learning how to build and maintain healthier relationships. Another cycle that I think that we can get caught up in is what I'm calling the cycle of control. You know, some of us do love to control circumstances. We do love to control what's happening around us and what's going on in our lives. And you know, we can all relate to this idea that we don't want to live lives that are out of control. But I think some of us end up controlling our lives, and we do it because we think we're always right. And so we screen out alternative ideas, and in so doing, we start to limit or to shrink our lives. Others of us control our lives because we're actually quite fearful. We're fearful of what might happen if we let go of the steering wheel or loose the reins, so to speak. So whether it's pride or whether it's fear or something else that's fueling our control, there's something powerful about breaking the cycle of control that's going to limit our lives, that's going to reduce or shrink our lives by actually trusting, by submitting to, you know, maybe somebody else's way or somebody else's option, you know, with wisdom. But there's something about trusting and saying, I'm going to step out here and I'm going to give this a go. Finally, last example I wanted to bring was what I'm going to call the cycle of indecision. You know, sometimes I've found myself going nowhere, and that can be such a frustrating place to be. Or I've seen others talking about the fact that we just never seem to know what our vision is. We never seem able to make the decision. We're never quite sure what to do. And, you know, I've seen this in relationships, in marriages, and it's very often in marriage driven by a lack of agreement. And truthfully, an unwillingness to listen to voices outside of our marriage as well. And again, it just touches on the voices of leadership in our lives. You know, I think that the way that we break out of the cycle of indecision, because if we get stuck in this cycle, we're just going to find ourselves static in life. The way that we break out of it is we grab a hold of vision. We either figure out what our personal vision is, or we do as I have certainly done in my life, which is I get behind somebody else's vision. One of the most debilitating things can be that we're not sure what our vision is, but neither are we willing to run with somebody else's. Giving ourselves to somebody else's vision is an incredible thing to do. Throwing our weight and our energy and our passion will help us break out of the cycle of indecision and help us see fruitfulness in our lives. Our cycles are driven by how we think, feel, or what we choose. And a different choice can break the cycle. A different choosing to respond in a different way, choosing to act in a different way, choosing to behave in a different way to the default sort of response that we find ourselves making is so powerful in breaking the cycle. I think I've just shared six words that can be transformational in our lives if we're willing to take a hold of them. The word discipline, the word accountability, the word forgiveness, the word trust, the word submission, the word vision. These are the words that will help us break out of cycles in our lives. We need to choose these things, make a different choice in our life to see the cycle broken. You know, why does this really matter? Well, I think it matters because going round in circles really does limit our lives. Going round in circles, as I've said, is necessary at times. It's part of the path for the course, as they would say, part of the journey in life. But it's something that can cost us dearly. It can cost us opportunity. As the cycle repeats, our circumstances and our opportunities, I think they shrink. But when we break out of the cycle, we see breakthrough, we see growth, we see transformation, we see ourselves step into more of God's opportunity. We're able to move forward in life. So I wanted to finish up this message by presenting you with three simple steps that I've put to work in my life, and I think that we can all put to work in our life, where we identify these cycles, we can put these steps to work. They help us, you know, develop a way of moving forward in life. The first step for breaking out the cycle is, I'm calling it reflect with honesty, reflect with honesty. You know, we need to grow our capacity to honestly self-reflect or self-analyze in life. You know, there's nothing more frustrating when you hear somebody repeat a story and you listen to it and you think, that's actually not how it went. You hear somebody telling you the story from their perspective that sort of paints them as either the hero or the victim and puts all of the responsibility on somebody else. That kind of dishonest self-reflection is going to lock us in cycles in our lives. We need to honestly self-reflect. It's one of the greatest strengths that I think that we can develop. Naomi and I, if you were to ask us, we would say, you know, when we first got married and when we first started stepping up in leadership, when we found ourselves returning to the same circumstances, our response in those moments were usually, why are they doing this to us? What's wrong with them? Why has God put us back here in these circumstances? But over time, we've had to develop a different response. We've had to start saying, you know, why do I feel the way I feel, and what can I do to change the outcome in this set of circumstances? What is going on inside of me, and how do I respond differently so I'm able to break out of the cycle? That's become much more familiar and common, and it's a really empowering thing when we find ourselves getting caught up in cycles. The Bible says in the book of Lamentations, chapter 3, verse 40, it says, let us examine our ways and test them, and let us return to the Lord. Honest self-reflection, let's examine our ways and test them, and let's return to the Lord. So the first step is to reflect with honesty. The second step, I'm calling it reposition to repentance. Reposition to repentance. You know, the world that we live in doesn't typically instruct or charge us to assume a posture of repentance. Usually what it says to us is that either we're a victim, either we can get locked in denial, or that somehow we have certain entitlements. And these things, these postures, prevent us very often from being able to move forward. And let me just expand on that a little bit more. You know, sometimes people are genuinely victims in circumstances, and I'm not seeking to sort of to pretend that that's not the case. But I do at times see myself defaulting to putting myself into the position of the victim, almost making myself a victim, and in so doing, disempowering myself. Or I see people, you know, living this place of denial where it's like it was all their fault. They're the ones that need to come and say sorry, or that organization, it's on them, or those people are responsible for this. And at times, you know, there can be a disproportionate weight of responsibility upon one person or one organization or one people group perhaps than another. But there's something about when we wait, again, we disempower ourselves. Or perhaps we feel an entitlement. I deserve an apology from them. I'm waiting for them. They need to fix this. The problem with these positions is that they don't help us break cycles. They don't help us move forward. In fact, what they do is they lock us in. But again, the repositioning to repentance causes us to look inward and say, what could I have done differently in this situation? What do I need to take responsibility for? Perhaps it's just that one thought. Perhaps it's just that one reaction. Usually, I think if we were honest in conflict situations and things like that, in cycles, there's usually a little bit more that we could take responsibility for. And then saying, God, I'm sorry that that's how I responded. When we repent, we respond with humility. And we say, God, I don't want this. I don't want the conflict. I don't want to be in this situation again. I don't want to get stuck in this place again. I don't want to be feeling this way. I don't want to be caught up in this. It's not your best. I want my heart to be free of this. I want my life to be free of this. And repentance says, I'm sorry for what I've done, God. And again, now I'm going to necessarily, repentance isn't repentance if we don't turn around and say, I'm going to go now in a different direction and I'm going to take a different approach and I'm going to try something different. When we reposition to repentance, yes, even in situations where we look and say, this isn't all on me. No, but there is something that I can do here to stop myself getting stuck in this place. And sometimes, truthfully, it is largely our responsibility, and especially in those moments, we need to therefore take responsibility. We need to repent. Where we shrug it off and where we push it away. You know, I want to speak especially about situations where we fail. Sometimes in the world that we live in, it can be so hard to admit personal failure. When we actually take responsibility, it's such an empowering thing. You can't move forward in circumstances where there's been a personal failure unless you take responsibility. You get locked in to that place, and that place can become a cycle if we're not careful. So we need to reposition to repentance. The third step that I think that we can take is the step to respond differently, to respond differently. Now, what I mean by this really is, this is the summary of the message, isn't it? Don't get stuck in the cycle, respond differently. It's take a different approach. Don't do what you usually do, try something different. And the amazing thing about God is he usually puts somebody somewhere in our lives to bring some leadership, to bring some direction, and to bring some guidance. I don't know if where you live in the world, they have this thing called a roundabout, but a roundabout is a circle basically in the road. You drive up to it and you go round it, and there are usually 5 or 6, maybe 4, 3 exits off this roundabout. The reason I'm sharing this is I've noticed in my life when I've got stuck going round and round in circles going, God, I don't know what to do. I'm here in this place again. Why is this happening again? God usually positions somebody on the right exit, and they stand there going, hey, take this exit, Chris, this way, come this way, come there. Oh, he's gone around the roundabout again. Hey, Chris, come this way. You know, they're stood on the exit speaking wisdom and speaking, health and speaking direction into my situation. Sometimes we'll find it very challenging to hear, but they're there. God has positioned them there going, come on, this is the way to go. Don't keep going round in circles. There's something about when we're caught up in circles, that is a voice we tend not to want to respond to. We look and we say, what's he doing? I'm not going to listen to him. He doesn't look like he knows what he's talking about. He doesn't look old enough to direct the traffic. I don't even know that person well enough. We're not enough invested in life together for him to give me direction. And we just get stuck going round and round in circles. And it's like, there's somebody saying, come this way. The other thing that we do in this situation is, it's like we're in our vehicle. We fill our vehicle up with voices that say to us, oh, you're fine the way you are. Now, I found myself stuck in cycles looking for voices of agreement rather than responding to the challenge that comes through the voice of leadership. The problem with that is the voice of agreement is typically somebody else who shares the same vulnerabilities or is compromising in the same way as me or isn't willing as a friend to be a good enough friend to say, hey, this is not God's best. We don't want to listen to the voice of agreement in those moments. We want to respond to the voice of leadership and direction. Responding differently so often involves us listening to that voice of leadership and saying, okay, I'm going to give it a try. It may not come naturally, but I'm going to give it a try. We have to respond differently. Proverbs chapter 13, verse 18 says this, "Whoever disregards discipline comes to poverty and shame, but whoever heeds correction is honored." There are so many moments in Proverbs. That's not a promise, that's a proverb. There are so many moments in Proverbs where it says, hey, this is the way to go. Respond differently, listen to the voice, you know, take a different approach. It's part of the kind of the richness that you'll find in a number of different Proverbs, and there's such wisdom in it for our lives as well. As I finish this up, I just want to repeat the three keys to breaking out the cycle, three steps to break out the cycle: reflect with honesty, reposition to repentance, and respond differently. Reflect with honesty, reposition to repentance, and respond differently. My prayer is, if you like me have found yourself caught up in cycles, small cycles or big seasonal cycles in life, that these will help you to get going in breaking the cycle and stepping into more of the promise or more of the potential that God has got and written into your life. And I just want to finish by speaking to two groups of people. The first person I want to speak to is the person that's listening to this and saying, you know what? Yeah, maybe, but I don't think that this is for me. He doesn't understand. He doesn't know. He's not familiar with my circumstances. And you're already potentially closing your heart to this message. God does not want you to stay stuck in the cycle. God wants to break you out today through responding differently. And my prayer for you today is that you would listen to what has made such a difference in my life and put it to work in your life in a way that is fruitful. The other person that I want to speak to as I finish up is the person that's listening to this going, yeah, I've had enough of the circle. I want to break out of it. Put these things to work. Seize a hold of these things. And I believe that you will see breakthrough in the days ahead. God bless you.
You have one life and two options. Give your life to God or give your life to the world. To live and operate in the fullness of God's power, we have to tune our lives, our mind and soul into God's frequency, the frequency of a new creation. But there is interference on his wavelength. Our stuff, our baggage, our pride, our earthly distraction. This is the white noise that clouds the voice of God, the static that conflicts with the beautiful heartbeat of Christ. You have one life, and it is a vapor on the wind. Don't flood it with noise. I can't hold the things of God if I have my hands gripped to my own plans and worldly ideals, hanging onto my past with my nails dug into fear. Liberate the capacity of your heart. Drop the distortion of the world. Have your hands free to pick up the Christ-like life. Pick up your cross. And don't think for one second that your cross is a burden. This isn't the weight of the world. Jesus took that on at Calvary. This is your cross. This is your surrender. Laying down your life for the one who gave you your life. This is part of the design, but not without trial. A fool desires a life of comfort. Yet this is real fullness, not some cheap thrill you pay for today and fades away tomorrow. This is eternal, miracle witnessing joy. Surrender. This is how we tune into God's frequency, into his power, world-transforming kingdom power. Christ surrendered everything, then gave the history books an empty tomb. Surrender equals resurrection power. So surrender your thoughts. Choose to listen to him rather than the voices of a broken world. Surrender your heart. Choose to walk in the ways of love rather than compromise. And why? Because a broken world needs healed people. A lonely world needs brothers and sisters who are full to overflow. With your hands full, you can't get a grip on your cross. So drop the noise. Pick up your cross and see his power. then see the world change. You have one life and two options.
Man, one life, two options. What are you gonna do? It's such a powerful question. This week, we have that opportunity to live for Jesus. But if you're here and maybe you've never made that choice, maybe you've never made that commitment, or maybe you once had, but perhaps these last few years you've been away from God, away from church, there's people either online in the chat or in home church or in our venues that would love to help you take next steps, because we're passionate about connecting people with that life-changing relationship with Jesus. So if you want to know more about what it is to follow God, reach out in one of those ways relevant to where you're doing church today, because we would love to support you take your next step with God.
We hope that you've had a great week here with us. I know we have. So wherever you're joining us or wherever you're going to join us next week, we look forward to having you here.
Come on, have a great week, church.